Hey everybody, welcome back to Wine Up TV. On our show today, we have Mark from Valley View Vineyards, which is in Applegate Valley, Southern Oregon region, on our show, and it's going to be great. We're going to do a Viognier, a Tempranillo, a Syrah, and a dessert wine, which is a late harvest Sauvignon Blanc. See you in a second. On today's show, Mark from Valley View Vineyards. Mark, thank you very much for taking the time and coming up here and telling the people all about your wines. You're a very old, so to speak, winery down in Southern Oregon.
We are. We were one of the very first in Oregon. My parents started the winery with the vineyard almost about 40 years ago.
Wow.
We've been making wine continuously since 1976, so we've seen a lot of changes in the Oregon wine industry. I literally have grown up with it, as my brothers have as well. And it's really been exciting to see all the positive change and the growth that Oregon has had in its wine industry.
Sure, and you know, I tasted your first wines. I was telling Mark, first time I had Valley View wines were at the Newport Seafood and Wine Festival in Newport, Oregon. I think it was like 88 or 89. So that's quite a while ago.
We actually won our very first medal ever in 1978, which was a gold medal at Newport.
No kidding.
We've continuously been going to the Newport Festival. We're the only winery to have gone every single year. It's been held.
That, you know, I'm gonna try to get some press passes this year and take Mark down, and we're gonna film a little bit down there because it's a really cool event.
It is.
It was a lot better back in the 80s, early 90s when kids were allowed. Now it's adults only.
Right.
Now it's just all the boozers come. You know, so I stay away on Saturday, man. That place gets just packed.
Friday and Sunday are the days to go.
You see the wine guys. We know when to go. All right. So you guys started out back in the 70s. Went through a couple different winemakers in the beginning, and you've had the same winemaker now for the last 25 years.
Right, his name's John Guerrero. We hired him day after he graduated from Davis with a winemaking degree, and he has been making wine. This last vintage was his 25th vintage.
Holy moly, that's great for you to keep him around.
It really is, because there's certainly a lot of variation in winemaking year to year, but it's invaluable what 25 years of experience can bring. So even though we've had maybe a few unusual vintages the last couple of years, a little bit cooler, for us it's nothing new. We know exactly, you know, how to deal with it and what comes out of it.
You know, I've always looked at Applegate Valley or the Rogue Valley, which is down in Southern Oregon, actually like an extended arm of Napa, because you have the hills, you have warmer summertime temperatures than we do up here in the Willamette Valley, and the soils are different. So the trend of planting different grapes down there are really getting pretty cool. You know, Tempranillo, Syrah, some Sauv Blanc. What other kind of varietals are you messing around with?
You know, we started out growing a whole bunch of different things 30, 40 years ago.
Everybody
because we
did.
Didn't really know. And we've narrowed it down to a certain extent, and then we've expanded it again. So the best thing about Southern Oregon is also, in a sense, one of its worst problems, which is we don't just focus on one red or two reds and one white. We have so many different varieties. So for consumers, it's great because they can go to three different wineries and try 10 different varieties. But for sort of the wine trade and the media, they still kind of are looking for, you know, what do you guys do?
Sure.
But certainly in terms of white wines, Chardonnay was the big one back then. It's still a pretty good player. But Viognier is, if there is a white wine, it would be Viognier and its
cousins.
I'm
a big fan of Viognier. All right, so the first one we're going to try is a 2008 Applegate Valley, Oregon Viognier. Is this most of it estate fruit?
Most of it is estate fruit. Over 90% of this is estate. A third of, or about a quarter of our vineyard now is Viognier. It's the only white we grow, though we just grafted some Roussan, so we'll be adding Roussan.
Okay.
This does have a small amount of Roussan in it as well.
I love those varietals. You know, especially when you start blending a little bit together.
Right.
They really add complexities from one end to the other. So this is nice. So tell us about the 2008 vintage overall.
Well, 2008 was, you know, a moderately warm vintage. It wasn't certainly the hottest we've had, but in the last 5 years, it was one of the warmest of the last 5 years. We seem to be going into maybe a 10 or 15 year cooler than average period here throughout Oregon, and maybe we're 5 years into it. So 2008 was certainly a nice break from 2007, which was noticeably cooler. But historically, it was pretty close to average.
All right.
You know, even though the Rogue Valley in Southern Oregon is so much warmer and drier than the Willamette Valley, there's still a lot of variations.
Sure.
So we are in the Applegate. We are a little bit cooler, and Viognier and Tempranillo especially do well. It ripens and gets this really nice.
It's a pretty honey nose.
And
yeah, it's a little
apricot aroma.
Yeah, a little peach, a little right. apricot, really honey. I noticed that.
But often, to get those right flavors in Viognier, if you're in too warm of a climate, the sugars go way high. You know, you have to
Absolutely.
Get 25, 26, and then the alcohols are at 14, 15%, and it tends to clash with some of these real bright flavors.
Kind of like that double dead guy ale. Hello, Rogue Valley Brewery. You know, I don't need one glass of beer when I go out and have a beer. Yeah, you're right, though. You struggle with that ripeness. Too ripe, you know, like Napa. I love Napa Valley wines, but over the top, full bore ripeness, juicy, jammy. But, of course, with that comes a little higher alcohol
right.
most times.
Right.
But if you ever drink some of the Napa Valley wines, I'm sure some of your wines back in the day are 12.5%, 13%.
Exactly.
They're earthier. They're there. They're structured. You know, but now people just want bigger, bolder, brighter.
I could pull open some of our wines from the late 70s, early 80s, some wines that we thought, you know, got tons of attention, were big, bold, round wines. Some of them were 12%.
Yeah.
You know, so it really is not an indication of, you know, of structure and strength. It's simply an indication of how much sugar is converted to alcohol.
Sure. Let's get this little taste. Some of this is a little barrel age on it.
It's settled in neutral oak
okay.
for about a month.
It's got that little creaminess to it, which I like. You know, you can stainless steel tank ferment this whole thing, which you probably do.
We often
fermentation.
Do. Right, right.
But yeah, it's got that nice creaminess to
right.
it.
We like to just sort of keep it in the barrel for about a month. It tends to settle it out. We don't have to really filter it much at all. And then it does sort of round it out a little bit.
All right, so the next wine, this is kind of putting Southern Oregon on the map, Tempranillo. You know, a grape varietal that's most common found in Spain. Real interesting. You want to rinse that? Or?
Oh, it's fine. Yeah, Tempranillo is something...
Thought we were going to drink out of
that. Yeah. No, just keeping the wine bottles on.
And there you go.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right, man. My bad. What was I thinking?
After you've done this for 25 years or so, you learn the little tricks. We actually, you know, we sort of laugh about this, but it's a serious question, which is that in 2003... We grafted Tempranillo onto our oldest Cabernet plant. Some had planted in 72, some planted in 76. So you're talking about 35-year-old Cabernet plants. So we always say we have the oldest Tempranillo in Oregon.
There you go.
And, you know, people sort of laugh and say, no, it's not. And I'm like, well, kind of is.
Sure.
I mean, that plant is a 35-year-old plant. It's working. It's going through the roots and everything like that. We don't really market it that way, but it is interesting to taste Tempranillo that's grown on, you know, 35-year-old roots. Versus, you know, the younger plantings that we have.
And that's not uncommon to field graft over. Because I remember right. up here in the Willamette Valley, when the Pinot Gris craze came along, everybody field grafted Chardonnay, which wasn't the best clone.
Right.
You're right. They're still the old stocks. They're still the roots are going down. But they field grafted like Pinot Gris in there. They'll do some other varietals. So.
Yeah, and Tempranillo is such a vigorous plant. It needs a lot of wide spacing. And the old spacing back then was 8x12, which nobody really plants 8x12 anymore because it's such a wide spacing. But Tempranillo is a very vigorous plant, so it really fills up that
2006.
That
spot. It's got some bottle age on it, too.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed when I pulled the cork out, some tartrates.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit of sediment in there.
Right, right.
The wine is alive.
We tend to, you know, relatively minimally process our fruit. We try to filter as least as possible and... try to manipulate as least as we can. We don't use a whole lot of barrel influence. We want that there, but we want it there, you know, as a compliment. We don't
sure.
want you to smell the wines and just say, you know, geez, that's a $1,000 French oak barrel right there.
Yeah, you know, this is it's got a nice mouthfeel on it. This wine here would go great with a steak. It's got some nice acidity, and I think a lot of Italian dishes.
Yeah, it's not, you know, it's not a hit you over the head Spanish red variety. You know, I mean. Viognier has characteristics much more like Pinot Noir to us, or even Syrah, than say the Bordeaux variety.
Sure.
Really shows where it's grown. This is 100% estate out in the Applegate. Again, you know, we can get the ripeness and still be around the 13% alcohol range, which is where we'd like to be.
Yeah, this is 13.2. No, this is a really nice wine. Again, you know, the problem is I just opened these up before you got here, so... You know, give this about another 20, 25, 30 minutes
Definitely.
In the glass. Let it breathe a little bit, you know, let it open up and show its true form. But I like it. It's very nice. This is a retail What is this?
Oh, 24.
24 bucks. All right. And
what's fun about Tempranillo is that it doesn't have real hard tannins when it's young, or most of the time it doesn't. Yet it ages amazingly well.
Yeah.
It really does age.
For an 06, yeah, it's still vibrant, it's still fresh.
It's still its way up.
It's still got it. All right, next wine. 2006 Syrah. You know, I've noticed a lot of wineries lately have all these older vintages. You know, the economy hasn't been great, and there's a little back stock of wines. Is this your current vintage?
Well, it is, although we're towards the end of the 06 and moving to the 07. Okay. But we have always been this way. Since we are an older winery, we store our own wine, we make a lot of wine, we sell it mostly retail, and then, you know, through a few select outlets, we try to keep the wine back to where it's ready to drink. So it's not that unusual for us to release wines out of vintage.
Okay.
You know, for instance, in 04, which was just a big, hot, dry year in Oregon, made really big, pretty backward wines. 05 was a cooler, more elegant style. In many cases, we released the 05s and held back on the 04. So we still have some 04s that we don't sell them a lot, but we sort of have them around there. We like to give people who come to Taste Room, you know, an experience. We like to give, you know, retailers, certain restaurants who want something a little bit older for a reserve list. And so we keep a lot of wines back. We self-distribute all of our wines. So you don't have distributors sort of just really getting on you for that last vintage that everyone's selling. So
sure.
We're atypical. We figure we might as well run with the atypical parts and go with what we would like to do as wine drinkers.
What this smells like? To me, I get roasted barbecue brisket. It's got that roasted meat, which is typical for Syrah.
Right.
And it's almost got like a barbecue sauce on it.
Well, you know, again, you don't get a lot of these flavors sometimes when the wine's 2 years old. You know,
yeah,
helps when it's three or four years old.
Very,
you know, you tend to just get that real bright cherry fruit. And, you know, if you want to have that, you have to age the wine yourself. We sort of want our wines, you know, if you want to age it, great. You could age either one of these reds for, you know, 3 to 5 years and you'll be fine. But you don't have to.
Yeah, well, it's already 3 to 5.
True.
Yeah, so they're already, and this Syrah, it's got a nice front palate, really nice mid palate, and a good finish. Real, just got a lot of length to that. But I've got that roasted meat that I get on the nose. This is just it's interesting. Very, and the retail on this is,
you know, the standard retail again is about 24, but you know, there's places that'll go 15 on this.
Really?
Yeah.
I might be one of those places. So wonderful. All right, now some of my favorite wines, as a lot of you guys know, sweet wines. I love dessert wines. I do. I've been a fan of dessert wines for years. Maybe it's my White Zinfandel days in high school. Eeks, college? Okay, we'll go college. Growing up on that Manischewitz. Oy vey. This is a late harvest Sauvignon Blanc. Tell us a little bit about this. Great packaging, by the way. Look at that bottle.
You know,
doesn't fit
dessert
anymore.
Wines really are a labor of love because, you know, everybody, or not everybody, but many people love them. They might buy a bottle, they stick it in their cellar, we just have to push people to drink it. Sort of a little bit like bubbly, you know.
Yeah.
It's not just for celebrations, it's not just for, you know, that extra special time. But we really love them, they do really well down there. This is a single vineyard, Sauvignon Blanc, from the Grants Pass area. And what we do is we pick it, you know, about as ripe as we can get it, which is typically around 25 to 26% sugar. We then freeze the grapes, then we press them while they're frozen, so it concentrates the sugar.
I got an ex-wife that can touch those grapes, we'll freeze them right away.
Maybe we'll get them
out. Yeah, nice. Oops.
So it'll end up, we press this out pretty close to 40% residual sugar. So then it very slowly ferments. You think all that sugar, the yeast would love it, but it's not really the case. It actually takes a little while for it to ferment that long. And then we age this in about a year and a half in French oak. Which is a little bit different. We do a Viognier, we do a Pinot Gris in this style as well. Those we just do in stainless. But the Sauvignon Blanc, partially because we sort of have this vision of Sauternes, which is Sauvignon Blanc and Semillon, the oak balances out the sugar, adds another dimension of a little toastiness and layers.
I love this nose.
Yeah.
I'm a big fan. I just love these. There's a few wineries here in the Llano Valley that make late harvest stuff, not necessarily from fruit here, but from like Walla Walla, Yakima Valley, Columbia Valley, and of course this stuff comes from the Applegate or Rogue or to the Grants Pass area.
It ends up about 14% residual, which is, you know, in that range. That's sweet, but it's not sickly syrupy sweet. We sort of let it go where it's going to go.
I like the acidity, too. Mm-hmm. Really bright. Even though it's sweet, it's got that, I'm salivating, it's got that acidity that really balances this wine out. The mid palate's fantastic. Absolutely stunning on the mid palate on this wine. It's pair this up with a peach tart, pear tart, a sorbet.
Poached pears. You throw in a little caramel sauce. It really, brings out some of that caramely oak.
This is slurpy-ish right here. I love this.
Well, when you concentrate the sugar, you're also concentrating the acid.
Sure.
So, and you need that. Otherwise, dessert wines, if there's one thing we would like to be able to tell everybody out there, don't be afraid of them. Experiment with them. They're not just for dessert.
Absolutely.
The French have them with frog gras before, their meals. And
I love that. Shove that liver down. Let's look thing.
It's a textural thing. It's a silky
essence
that it's indescribable. So pull it out, open it up, say, I'm going to, tomorrow night we're going to, have this dessert wine.
Oh.
And, you really, it just makes the meal, makes the whole night better.
So there's no barcode on this. You don't make a lot of it.
We do not make a lot of that. It retails right around the upper 20s, right about $28.
This is a 500 milliliter bottle?
No, it's a half bottle.
That's a half, 375. Look at the packaging.
And it does, it goes pretty long because the sugar and the alcohol, you don't have to finish the whole thing all at once.
Sure.
It'll stay at least a week or so in your fridge. So, you can have just a few ounces here and there.
I like that. That's a delicious wine. Would you guys make one barrel, two barrels?
We made three barrels.
Three barrels, a drop.
Right about 2,000 of those barrels. But the 08, which this is running towards the end, the 08, I believe, we're pretty close to four barrels. So we're about 2,400 bottles or so.
You are just increasing.
Touch sweeter than this, about 16% residual. But, again, where the yeast chooses to stop, we let it go. So it could be anywhere from 12 to 18%. But again, we're really just going for that balance.
And this is a labor of love. These wines are not easy to make. You have to freeze the grapes. You got to press them when they're frozen. They're just different.
This is not a wine that you pencil out in the sense, because you might put in a ton of grapes in that press. You're not getting anywhere near the equivalent juice, because so much of that is staying as ice, which is just the water.
Just the water.
And then you can't really press them much because they're frozen.
Yeah.
So your yield, if you can get 40% of what you normally would have come out with, you're doing okay.
Sure.
So, you think about that where you're paying 2.5 times
now,
the equivalent.
When you say these grapes ripen up to about 27 bricks naturally out in the fields, are birds a problem down there like they are up here?
Year there was. This year I haven't heard any bird expert, but really, I bet there was something going on, because if there was one consistent
Alfred Hitchcock thing,
one consistent thing this year in 2010, birds up and down the West Coast,
everywhere
from the Central Valley all the way through up into Okanagan, everybody complained about the birds. I have my own little theory, which is that everything was 3 weeks late, it seems like, this year. And because we had such a glorious fall, we didn't really have the freezing nights and what would sort of move us into the fall. Birds don't have a calendar. So, even though it was the middle of October, they're still thinking, this is the end of September, because we had September weather in October. So there was no pressure, and yet we had these incredible fruit out there. So they went to town.
So what's cool about Valley View Vineyards is they've been around for years, since the 70s. So they have all these notes and all these records to keep track of. Every vintage is completely different, like we talked about. If you guys are ever in Southern Oregon, give Mark a call. I'm sure he'll hook you up at the tasting room. And if you want any of these wines, I have these wines locally. These are your smaller production wines. I know you guys sell some to some larger chain stores.
We do.
But I don't usually carry all the stuff. You'll find these at bottle shops pretty much. Most of them don't have barcodes on them, which is cool. So, again, everybody, thank you very much for tuning in. Next time we'll have a different winemaker on the show, and we'll pimp out their wines as well. So you guys have a great afternoon or evening or morning. See you later. Thanks, Mark.
Thank you, Wayne.